got new computers a couple years ago, and there's no microphone in there, so I bought this microphone, but it doesn't pick it up very well.
Put a cone on it?
Wah, bah, blue, bah, wah, bah.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. No, what I need is, I need to get a different one that's like a wireless one that you can wear. Or like the, hello.
Does any picture we take in here?
I know we got one, but it's a big problem.
Who wants to take it, because I don't think you look to, I don't know, take it, that's, so.
What is it for?
You look. So, but when they look back, and they go, do you remember when old Mr. Aldrich?
There's plenty of time, there is time.
I got it here until at least one.
At least one?
Yeah.
I want to remember the one that was back in the community.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You remember old Mr. Aldrich?
Yeah, they'll be like, you remember old Mr. Aldrich, what's that guy's name?
Oh, like Paul.
He was like.
He liked Paul.
Long hair, no wait, that was a different guy. He seems like that guy.
He had beard down to here, you know?
No, that, no, that was a different, no, that was a different guy.
Yeah.
I can't remember that guy, he'll be.
Aldrich, I remember, if you retired in your little girl graduate.
Hopeful. Market's hipping down. Portfolio's lost 8% of its value since June.
Assuming my little brother graduates.
Yeah, the stock market is good now.
Okay, back to, this. All right, so the first one, I don't know how many of you got this wrong, I didn't go through and check this time. It says the point 4, comma 2 lies on the curve, y equals the square root of x. If q is the point x square root of x, use your calculator to find the slope of the secant line. So one of the points they gave us is 4, 2. The other point, the x coordinate is 4.01, and then you take the square root of 4.01, and you get 2.002498. And then you go y2 minus y1 divided by x2 minus x1, and you get an answer of 0.2498.
Four.
I did this one to 6, and then when I divided by 0.01, it canceled out 2 of them, so minus 0.4. Okay? Is there anybody who got that wrong that doesn't understand what they did?
I got it wrong, but I wrote it out in the
Do you understand what you're supposed to do? Okay. All right, next one was real similar to that, except for this time you're getting the points off of the table. It says the position of a car is given by the values in the following table. Estimate the instantaneous velocity when t equals 2 by averaging the average velocities from the period 1 to 2 and 2 to 3. So from the period 1 to 2, what was the change in distance? 24. What was the change in time? 1. So the average velocity from 1 to 2 was 24 feet per second. What was the average velocity over the time interval from 2 to 3? No. It changed 35 over again a time of 1. So the velocity there was 35 feet per second.
Oh my gosh, I wrote this, my 7 was like a 2, so I just, oh my gosh.
So then when you take the average of those two, you get a final answer of
29.5.
Okay, question? Some question, Logan? The 24 comes from 37 minus 13, okay? And the 35 comes from 72 minus 37. Because 1 to 2 is 1 and 2 to 3 is 1. This is our time, and that's our distance, okay?
Okay, and then number 3 is basically the same thing. It says the rock is thrown upward on the planet Mars with a velocity of 10 meters per second, it's 90 meters all along the block.
So you take and you plug in t equals 1, and you get a distance of, if fallen, 8.14. And then you plug in t equals 2, and it has fallen a distance of 12.56. Okay? So your average velocity is the change in distance divided by the change in time, which is 4.42.
Can you tell me about
divided by 1, which is 4.42 meters per second. Okay? So I think, what?
Y is like that, is that the distance?
Yeah, this is the distance, and this is the time. So average velocity is the change in distance over the change in time. So here's the change in distance.
So it's the velocity of
some kind of
E squared.
T squared.
Okay, any other questions about number 3? Okay. What most of you did, Brooke explained to me, is you took these two distances and averaged them and got 10 point whatever? Yeah, okay. But these are not velocities, those are distances. So to find the average velocity, you have to go changing distance. Okay, number 4, write an equation that expresses the fact that function f is continuous with the number 3. I was very pleased with the number of people that got this correct, yeah, because this is sort of a weird problem. Some of you wrote a function that was continuous at 3, but that's not an equation, that's not what they're looking for. What they're looking for is for the definition of continuity, and that is that if the limit as x approaches 3 of the function equals the value of the function at that point, then your function is continuous at that point. Okay? And I think about half of you came up with that. So I'm pretty happy about that. That's the answer right there.
Yep.
And then I just completely forgot to do 5.
Good job.
I just wrote 5.
Okay, 5 wasn't necessarily easy. I would disagree with you there. 5, it says, find an equation of the tangent line of the parabola y equals x squared plus 6x at the point 3, 27. We will learn a technique in the next chapter that will make this problem be about a 30-second problem. Okay, when we get away from one time. Okay, what we're doing, I know, and I'm going to do this to you again here in February when we get into interval. What you need to start doing in the next chapter, especially if your name is Caleb Chastain and you really don't like limits, because you need to start looking at the answers that we get and the question that we started with and see, is there a way that I could have gotten that without doing all that work? Because what we're going to come up with in the end is formulas for these, so we don't have to use limits to come up with that. Okay? All right, but anyway, we don't have that. So what we have to do is we have to say, okay, when x equals 3, y equals 27. So I want to find the slope of this curve, so I'm going to check a point very close to 3, such as 2.9. Okay, we'll do both of those. So first we'll do x equals 2.9, and then we'll do x equals 3.1. So when I plug 2.9 into that equation, I get 2.9 squared plus, what was the other one? 6.2 times 2.9, and that comes out to be 25.81. 25.81, and then if I do the same thing with 3.1 squared plus 6 times 3.1 equals 28.21. So I'm not feeling anything good going on right there. Yeah. Okay, so we got to get closer to our point. So let's go x equals 2.99, and let's do x equals 3.01, and see if we get closer to our value. So 2.99 squared plus 6 times 2.99 gives me, am I doing the wrong formula? Okay, 26.88. Yes, that's right. And then you're 27.2. Why not? Because I made the same mistake you guys made on the test. So okay, so this is the coordinates of that point. Now I have to use that to find the slope. Okay. So if I take these two, if I go 25.81 minus 27 over 2.9 minus 3, that is negative 1.19. Is that right? I second teacher, over negative 0.1. So if I divide those, I get 11.9. Okay, and then if I do the same thing here, if I go y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, that gives me 1.21 divided by 0.1, which is 12.1. Okay, so what do these look like for a slope there? 12. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say the slope is 12. So once you know the slope is 12, it doesn't say what form to put it in, so you could leave it as y minus 0.7 equals 12 times x minus 3. Or you could write it in slope intercept form because you've been brainwashed at a very young age to do it that way, and that would give you 12x minus 9. Okay? You can always check your work in math. So if I took the original function x squared plus 6x and then graphed 12x minus 9, what you could see is there is. Oh, look, that line does look like it's tangent right up there. Yeah. Okay. So you know you got that right. Okay? Okay, then number 6. All of you, except for one person, I don't know if we'll call them lazier than the rest of you or smarter than the rest of you or both, plug in all of those points. And then what you actually, if you're like really on top of it, what you should notice is the limit is approaching 0.707. Some of you put 0.7 in there. But 0.707 is better. He just plugged in this one, and he plugged in this one. He plugged in the two closest ones to 2.
Which is smart.
Yeah, which is smart. And you get 0.707
all
of
all
of them. Yeah, I know.
I just need
the
keyboard.
Right, if you use a table on the calculator,
I
that's easier
to do.
I would
have, but I
don't know. Yeah, no, it's fine. It's fine.
And hey, I did the first one too, and then I realized.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't the second.
I have no idea.
It's all
yeah, that's not correct. Yeah.
If I did the first one, I said, wow, I'm not going to type all of them, so I'm going to,
I did that on one of the kids. And I like,
it
would
be
like 9.8.
And this actually, 0.707 should be a number that you recognize. The square root of 2 over 2,
okay, number 7. If you got this one wrong, negative 10 plus 8 equals negative 2. Okay? So,
I started doing all the algebra at first, and then I just read to evaluate the limit.
Did you get it wrong?
I wrote it down, I put the numbers here, I was like, that is too easy, and I thought, yeah.
All right, next one. We've done these quite a number of times. We've got a funky equation here, so we are going to rationalize the numerator, okay? There's one tiny little trick in here, okay, that could trip you up. So this is going to be the limit as x approaches 0. If I go first times first, I get 1. If I do the outsides, I get root 1 minus x squared. If I do the inside, I get negative root 1 minus x squared, so those cancel. And then it's going to be minus parentheses. I think that doesn't actually matter that we need 1 minus x squared.
But then I changed it because
it's. Okay, so then 1 minus 1 is gone. This negative and this negative cancel each other out, so we're really trying to figure out what the limit as x approaches 0 of x squared over x times 1 plus 1. I know. And then this x cancels one of those, you plug in 0, and you get 0. And are you guys familiar with the website 9gag? No? Okay. They have like little memes and just, this kind of stuff on there. And I flip through there sometimes and I see math ones and I think of you guys, and I saw one this morning that was like an entire page, seriously, like hardcore calculus ones that we're not even seeing yet, and then the final answer was like 1.
Okay, well, I'm confused on why
was kind of a weird one, and I told you guys, ah, don't worry about the squeeze theorem, we won't, but, you know, I see. So you could have gotten this wrong, you still got the A on the test. You put in negative 1 into here, you get 1. This one's 1, since this function is in between two 1s, then it must be 1.
And so I was supposed to plug in negative 1?
Yeah. Same thing with this one, evaluate the limit. There's no reason why you can't just plug in the 5 directly. And when you do that, you get 213.
That one made me worry.
I know, it's like, there's
only
like that limit
it,
like, why can't I plug it in?
Yeah, you plug it in. Okay, number 11, one person got it right. Nice job. This is a really tricky one. If you try, I tried to say, okay, I'm going to do this without a calculator because you guys might not know where this is on your calculator. Yeah, so if you make a table of values, what you notice is if you plug in negative 3, you get 0. If you plug in negative 2, you get 0. If you plug in negative 1, you get 0. So we're assuming all the integer values are 0. So then I'm going to try a decimal number. So I put in 0.5 and got 0.5. And then I put in 1.5 and I got 0.5. And so then that's kind of weird. So then you try a different number, like 2.99. I don't know why I did that one. But if I plug in 2.99, this, remember, rounds down. So this would be 2.99 minus 2, which would be 0.99. So then it turns out the graph looks like, what?
0.98,
yes. The graph looks like at the integer values, it equals 0. So 0 is right there. And then it goes up.
I thought for sure it would go up. We did, like, the day before on the
So that's a weird one. All right, number 12. We've done these quite a bit also.
Can I write down this?
Soap. So difference of two squares is t plus 2 times t minus 2. Difference of two cubes, our mnemonic is soap. So the So this first one is this sign is the same. That's what the S stands for. The next sign is the opposite, and the last sign is always positive.
So okay. how do you determine the root of 2?
Because the cube root of 2 cubes is t, and the cube root of 8 is 2. So that's where these two numbers come from.
But no, but I don't get that, but the minus is positive.
Okay, so this is the same, so it's going to be the same sign as that. This one is going to be the opposite. So if this was t plus 2, this would be t minus 2. So these two are always opposites of each other. And then the last one is always positive. Okay? And it's squared, multiplied together, squared. This formula, that's pretty
cool.
That
plus 4
plus
9.
Plus
4.
Hold on. Mr. August, let me see that one. Don't erase it. Don't, leave it for a second. Some people are wondering what this
is. Oh.
Same, opposite, always positive.
Oh, okay. Stop. So, thank you. Okay. What did you do? Yeah, that's fine. Yep, you can do that all. You can do that as well. You can always find limits that way. You can find limits just by graphing.
Wait, what'd you plug in?
1.99.
Yeah, that's what I did.
I didn't do the 1.9.
The only thing that I don't like about that is that you guys ended up with a decimal answer.
Yeah.
And if you do it this way, the t minus 2's cancel, you plug in 2. And
if I were thinking, I would have realized that 0.33329, that's it. But I would get one.
So, all right, number 13, randomly, is pretty much the same as 1, 2, and 3. The cost in dollars of producing X units of a certain commodity is that. Find the average rate of change with respect to X when the production level changes from 101 to 103. So you have to take and plug in 101, and if you do that, you get 6465?
Yeah.
0.08. And then if you plug in 103, you get 6523.72. And then you go y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. So you find the slope of those, and that is 29.3.
I did not make on the point. I did 0.8.
I'm sorry, I didn't make that for a second. So you said, like, I got that point.
Yeah, that's what rate of change is, another way of saying slope.
Okay.
So I will bring a basket to class tomorrow, and when you walk in the door, just leave your sign saying the basket. This one is also a super easy one. Blah, 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 says f of 3 is 3, so just plug a 3 into there and solve for g of x, and then you get.
I would probably get that out of there. I'm excited about
that. Okay, your grade is dropping because what you're doing is you're confessing that you don't understand this as well as you're doing this.
I really don't.
And so, what did you get on your test?
What's the one I have?
I got 12, I think it's
what percent? Okay, I'll bump that down like 82.
So, wait, so you just plug 3 into that.
Yeah, so 9 minus g of x equals 3.
Okay.
So 12. No, those aren't after value symbols, those are all after. Alright, 15, evaluate the limit. Once again, don't make it complicated. If you can plug in the number, plug in the number. If you plug in negative 9, you get 0.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Talk to us easy.
Like
alright, state the domain. Can't take the square root of a negative number, so as soon as p gets larger than 4, you have issues. And since you're squaring it, p also can't be less than negative 4. So the domain of this is what square bracket.
Yeah,
so you could also write it as negative 4.
Like,
this is the more like advanced math. Because this is really cumbersome. That notation. You know how Siri has a little pigment or whatever? That's mine.
Oh my god.
Don't ask me any more questions. Okay, determine the infinite limit. Well, the answer to the infinite limit is infinity. If you plug in a number just a little bit bigger than 0, so like if you take and plug in 0.001, then the thing on top is going to be just bigger than 1. This squared is going to be super small. Because reasons, yeah. Because this really small number squared is going to be even smaller, and then this is going to be just a little bit bigger than 7, okay? And so if I take a super small number times 7, I'm going to get a number that is also still super small. And then if I go 1 divided by super small, then I get infinity. Okay? And you have to check both, because it's possible that if you put in a number just larger than 0, you get a number that's negative infinity. So I'm also going to plug in negative 0.001, and when I do that, this becomes 0.999. This becomes still, this is the key, this is why it's infinity, because when I square it, the negative becomes a positive, so I still get a number that's super small. Okay, and then this is going to be 6.999, and then the same math holds for the rest of this. So my final answer is, okay, yeah, that's fine. It's like a It's the thoughts, really. Alright, number 18. This was off. Oh, this is big enough.
I think I've got a heart attack there.
Okay, 9 plus x to the negative 1, we can rewrite as 1 over 9 plus x. 9 to the negative 1, we can rewrite as 1 over 9, and then that's all over x. Okay? So now I have these fractions on top I need to get a common denominator with. So that common denominator will be 9 times 9 plus x. So what did I multiply the 9 plus x by to get 9 times 9 plus x?
9.
And what did I multiply the 9 by to get 9 plus 9 plus x?
9 plus x.
9 plus x. Remember your negatives. It's going to distribute.
I took it out of
the So 9 minus 9 cancels. And then that gives me negative x over 9 times 9 plus x over x. So now I can multiply that by the reciprocal, which is 1 over x. So those cancel. You're close. So that gives me negative 1 over 9 times 9 plus x, which if I plug in 9 gives me negative 1 over 81. And again, some of you children did this the way Colby said the other problem and plugged in a number very, very close to zero. That's fine, but again, the issue is you get a decimal number, which you don't recognize as being a fraction.
Oh, so you guys are plugging
in
a point zero.
Yeah, you can do it that way. But the problem would be if you're like doing multiple choice tests or something, and that wouldn't be the problem there, but that's going to get you to set it by.
That's
like you can always graph a function by making a picture.
That's what, yeah.
It seems like third grade, but you don't.
That's what I
did. So you can get
0.0001, and you're going to get a decimal really close to the
stuff. So you don't have to go negative.
You should technically go negative 2 just to make sure that the limit exists.
Yeah. It's like a.
Alright, and then last one, state the following, the limit as x approaches negative 4, well here's negative 4 right there, so this is going down, that's going down, so negative infinity was the commonly accepted answer, but some of you said the limit does not exist, and I gave you credit for that because negative infinity is not, do you want to retake it? Let me know.
Okay. You can't see right there. I did do my work and forgot to staple it. If you look on 7, I did do negative 10 plus 8 equals negative 2. I got it right, but I crossed it out because I was scared.
We already decided your grade is better than it really should be.
No, I just because so I got
we'll
lucky didn't do anything
right
already.
Right there.
Oh, this is the only test I'm ever going to do good on.
That's not true. Okay, so I don't know if you remember, you probably don't, at the very beginning of the year, but I told you the calculus has two pieces, and one of those pieces is derivatives, okay? Chapter 3, we will be working on until probably like Thanksgiving, okay? This is the heart of this class.
So you're saying that there's no chance that
you guys are. No, because we're going to take, I'm going to be good this year, and we're going to take quizzes periodically. Every year classes get mad at me because we spend like a month and a half on a step and then have a test. And we're like,
what?
Well, so we're going to break it down. We're going to break it down.
Is this true false quiz and a
yeah. Okay, so here's an interesting little thing to start with. Here is, I don't know what's going to happen there.
I've got Max coming.
Yeah. My sister-in-law lives in Alaska, and she has two boys that are in Alaska, but they're teenagers now, so they're up here. But when they were little, they used to do things called moose charges, like you would just be standing there and they would run at you and do a moose charge. And they actually had a rule in their family that you have to announce your moose charge. So you can't just run, and you have to, like, warn something.
Well, you say, like, moose charge!
Yeah, and then you go.
Oh my God.
They're hockey kids. They're nuts. Okay. So here is a graph of everyone's, one of their top 10 favorite functions. This is sine of x. Here is below it the graph of cosine of x. And here's something that you might notice, which you probably never thought about. What is the slope of the graph right here at this high point? What is the slope of this graph right here at this high point? Zero. See the tangent line right there? Okay, this is at the high point. What is the value of cosine at that same point?
Zero.
Interesting. What is the slope of this right here, would you maybe guesstimate? Negative one. What is the value of cosine at that point? Negative one. Huh. This has a slope of zero, value of cosine, zero. Slope of one, value of cosine, one. Interesting. Okay? So there's a relationship between the graph of sine of x and its slope and the graph of cosine. Okay? In this chapter, we finally, okay, we're beginning our study of differential calculus, which is concerned with how one quantity changes in relation to another quantity. The central concept of differential calculus is called the derivative, which is an outgrowth of the velocity and slopes of tangents that we did in the last chapter. After learning how to calculate derivatives, so we're going to learn how to do these, not figure out the limits, just do them. We use them to solve problems involving rates of change and approximations of functions. Okay? Ready? Okay, so the first section is on derivatives and rates of change. The problem of finding the tangent line to a curve and the problem of finding the velocity of objects both involve finding the same type of limit as we saw in the first section of chapter 2. This special type of limit is called a derivative, and we will see that it can be interpreted as a rate of change in any of the sciences or engineering. So we went through this at the beginning of class. We said if you want to find the slope like at this particular point P, you take two points, remember this? And then you find the slope of that line as it's getting closer, as this point is getting closer and closer to that. Okay, do you remember that? Yeah, and that's that guess and check thing that we did. Okay, so we are going to now make this a definition. The tangent line to the curve at y equals f of x, or the curve y equals f of x at the point a comma f of a is the line through P with the slope. The limit as x approaches a of f of x minus f of a divided by x minus a. Does this limiting idea make sense now for this thing? This is saying what we want to find this is if this is my point x and this is my point a, we want x and a to get closer and closer and closer together. Okay? And the limit of those two things is going to be the actual definition of the slope at that point. Okay, that's fine. This, you don't really need to because, I mean, f of x is just y2. That is a beautiful two. And f of a is y1, and then this is x2 minus x1. So all they're saying is they're just putting into calculus notation the idea of if you want the slope of the curve at a particular point, keep taking those secant lines and getting them, like you said, just keep getting closer and closer, do the guess and check until you get to the thing. Okay? So in our first example, we confirm the guess we made in example 1, section 2.1. So this says, find an equation of the tangent line to the parabola y equals x squared at the point P1, comma 1. So I don't know that when you remember, but when we did this before, we did what McKinsey said. And we took and we plugged in 1.1, and we plugged in 1.01, right? And we plugged in 1.001. Okay. What we're going to do now is we're going to use our new little definition for slope, which is the limit as x approaches a of f of x minus f of a over x minus a. So in this case, what is f of x? What? X squared. The function is x squared. Okay? So f of x is x squared. Minus, what is f of a? 1. Because I should erase this. A is 1 in this that's going to be over x minus 1. Okay? And now we don't have to do our little guessing step here because we're digits now. How can I solve that limit?
Factor.
So the top factors into x minus 1 times x plus 1 over x minus 1. X minus 1 cancel. So I get the limit as x approaches 1 of x plus 1. And now I can plug it in directly and I get an answer of 2. Okay? Which, if we went back to back to 2.1, this is one of those, this is the problem that we started with, and we did this by doing the guess and check thing, and we came up with an answer of 2 by just doing that, okay? Alright, so now we're getting away from the guess and check, alright? Okay, we sometimes refer to the slope of the tangent line to a curve at a point as the slope of the curve at the point, and so here is a graph of y equals x squared. And this is the window from 0 to 2, and then they zoomed in, so this is the window from 0.5 to 1.5, and then this is the window 0.9 to 1.1, and do you see what's happening to the curve as you zoom in closer, closer, closer? Yeah, it looks straighter and straighter and straighter, okay? So that's all we're doing, and giving us that idea of the 2 points approaching each other, okay? Okay, so here is an alternate definition for this, because if you substitute in, if you call the difference between those 2 points h, we want the difference of those 2 points to approach what? Zero. I'm going to change this to be as h approaches zero, and then instead of having x minus a on the bottom, I'm just going to call that h, which is another way that you can think of the slope at a particular point. Okay?
So it's the same thing.
It's the same thing, but you should write this down, because we're going to use this a lot. And you should recognize this. Do you recognize this? Yeah, nope. We did this A plus H thing a lot. We started doing it in pre-calculus, and then we did some already this year where you were randomly like, you said, hey, take A plus H from there, and then simplify it. That's why. Okay? Classic in algebra for this moment.
Why
would
you say
B? Why wouldn't I be,
okay, so next one, find an equation of the tangent line to the hyperbola y equals 3 over x at the point 3 comma 1. This is the last one that we'll have time to do. And this time we're going to use that second thing. So now I'm going to say I want this to be the limit as h approaches 0 of f of, what was it? X plus h? A plus h?
A plus h.
A plus h? You think I know. Minus f of a over h, okay? So what is a this time? 3. And what is f of a?
1.
Uh-huh. And what is f of x, just for fun? Yeah. So in this case, since a is 3, 3 divided by 3 is 1, okay? Alright, so here we go.
Algebra City. Stop. What is f of a plus h?
What?
What is f of
a plus h?
Yes. What is f of a plus h? What is f of a plus h?
One times the sine of 3 plus h.
1 plus a what?
Yeah, f of a plus h.
Okay, yes. I would say 1 plus a would be 1 plus h. Okay, 1 plus 3 over x is
saying is take a plus h and plug it into the function. She's good. All I did is I took A plus H and plugged it in there for the X. Okay? That's your answer? Okay.
Me play football.
All right. What is F of A? One. And then H is just going to be H. Okay? So this is now just a limit problem that we did before. So we just need to do some algebra to get some stuff to cancel. What's the algebra that we should do? Common denominator, and then reciprocal. So what is my denominator going to be? A plus H. Okay? I guess I'll do this in two steps. So this stays as 3, okay? And then this is going to be an A plus H on the top. Okay? Right? Because A plus H over A plus H is the same as 1. Yes, you have to distribute that negative. Good job, Cameron. So that's going to be 3 minus A minus H. Okay? Nothing was canceling there, so I was in a little bit of a panic. I apologize. When we go from the formula to the actual work, then we will replace all the A's with 3. Sorry about that. Okay. I don't know if you will. Yeah, right. Okay. Yes. So now we can have things and now we can cancel out these 3. So this 3 and this 3 cancel. This is limit as h approaches 0 of negative h over 3 plus h over h. And now we do the reciprocal that we're suggesting. So we get negative h over 3 plus h times 1 over h. So the h is canceled. Right? And then now we can plug in 0 directly. So we get an answer of negative 1 over 3.
No,
again, no guess detected.
Up on top of that.
Right here?
Yeah.
Right here? B3?
Yeah.
Okay, so tomorrow.